On the theme, accelerating investments in Indian Railways as an important engine of growth for the Indian economy. Ladies and gentlemen, under the aegis of Smart Cities and Infrastructure Committee, a series of international conferences is being organized by IMC, and this is the very first event in that series. As per the Indian tradition, the inauguration will be done by lighting the auspicious ceremonial lamp. I request our chief guest, Sri Suresh Prabhuji, Honorable Union Minister of Railways, to kindly do the honors. We also have with us Mr. Deepak Prem Narayan, President, Indian Merchants Chamber, Mr. Harishankaran, Chairman, IMC Infrastructure Committee and Vice Chairman and MD, RNFS. Our guest of honor, Mr. Deepak Parekh, Chairman, HDFC Limited, Mr. Lalit Jalan, CEO, Reliance Infrastructure Limited, Mr. Sunil Mathur, MD and CEO, Siemens India, Dr. Lalit Kanodia, Vice President, IMC, and Mr. Arvind Pradhan, Director General, IMC. Deepena Lokana Jayati, Deepas Tejo Maya Hasmritaha, Chaturvarga Pradodipan, Tasmat Deep Yajet Priye. This couplet in Sanskrit translates, the lamp is luminous, its radiance grants victory, its brightness imparts dharma, artha, karma, and moksha, that is righteousness, prosperity, pleasure, and emancipation. This is the significance of lighting a lamp, and hence a lamp should be lit. Lamp, as we all know, is also a symbol of knowledge. The lamp being lit, the conference being inaugurated, I request our esteemed guests and dignitaries to kindly take their seats on the dais. Ladies and gentlemen, as I was mentioning, you can see the ICS logo on my left, your right, on the flex, which is the backdrop of the stage, that stands for Infrastructure Conference Series. And as I mentioned earlier, there'll be a few more conferences that have been planned on topics like water, surface transport, etc. Topics including freight logistics, improved customer services and security, developing railway stations into business and tourism hubs, and many such will be deliberated upon today. Today's conference will provide a unique bouquet of benefits for participants and an excellent opportunity to take business to the next level by understanding the emerging opportunities and networking with government and private sector partners. We have eminent speakers, policymakers, government officials connected to the sector, financiers, and other stakeholders in the rail ecosystem. The conference will be followed with a detailed report to provide inputs to the ministry in its various discussions. So, let us commence by calling upon Mr. Deepak Prem Narayan, President, Indian Merchants Chamber, for the welcome address.
Morning, Honorable Minister Shri Suresh Prabhu, respected dignitaries, Dr. Bibek Debroy is on his way, Mr. Deepak Parekh, Mr. Jalan, Sunil Mathur, Harishankaran, and distinguished guests. On behalf of IMC, I wish you a very good morning and a successful participation in today's conference. IMC's vision is to enable global competitiveness. And that is important as far as our members are concerned. We have got 3,000 members, 225 affiliated associations, a reach of almost about 2 lakh companies. And competitiveness is very critical for us. And sir, what I'm going to lead to is that between the Prime Minister and yourself, this has been a main agenda in terms of increasing India's global competitiveness. And we are conscious that both of you have been on sync in terms of the various initiatives that you have taken. If I'm to say that your job, your function, is like running a country. It is so vast, so intricate, and there are so many issues. But in this short span of time, what you've achieved, if I might just put down in a few boxes. One is the out-of-box thinking. You know, for several decades, there wasn't any investment that was happening, which was in keeping what the requirement was because of money issues, and not the exchequer was not in a position to support that. But you thought out of the box, and what you did was got the purse of LIC to support the railways. So that was one. The second thing that you did was to merge the railway minister's budget with that of the national budget. Another very interesting out-of-the-box thinking is the your approach in terms of entering into joint ventures with in terms of tariff. And this should bring about almost 27,000 crores in terms of revenue to the railways. And then plus, tying up with long-term partners for tariff. I can't but mention that what has created global comfort is the transparency that you brought onto the system. And this comfort brings about reduction in interest cost. And that is important for our country to prosper in terms of our industry. Now take, for instance, the largest locomotive contracts in the history of this country were on e-tendered. Today, recruitment is through the net, which I'm actually unhappy, because if I was to apply today, I wouldn't stand a chance with my CV. So let me say that. Even you look at auctions, that has also gone in for e-auctioning of scrap and other things. This is all adding up to comfort globally. And the money that comes in, then it's not temporary money, it is sticky money. That it stays behind and it adds to the growth of our economy. So also on the corporate front, as a CEO, what you've done is also very interesting, is that for the first time, you don't have the members of the railway board who are working independently, but they are no longer in silos and they're working as a team, and you empowered them in terms of being with deliverables, which is also very heartening. On the initiatives that you've taken, the operating ratio is at 92%, which is extremely healthy today. What Lalu Prasad had launched out as railway minister to set up two factories in Bihar for locomotives, and it was in Marora and Madhepura. Within a short time of taking over as the minister, you implemented that, sir. And that is 30,000 crores that will come in by way of investment. This is something that hadn't happened for a long time. Even on terms of coal, all the demand has gone down. But during this period, the movement, the way it's been handled, so therefore, there is a lesser negative flow. So, as far as my other speakers go, Mr. Deepak Parekh has been a doyen in infrastructure, and he also needs no further introduction. I'm sure that will also happen today. Mr. Vivek Deb Roy is not here. I'm sure Hari in his talk will refer to that. And today's conference, I believe, will open up new vistas for each of us to interact and share ideas. I won't take up too much more time. I'll very quickly conclude that on behalf of IMC, if I might say, my friend Suresh, Deepak, who's always been a great supporter of IMC, sponsors, media, the ILNFS team, which has worked unrelentlessly, and the IMC team also. I believe they left office pretty late last night, and that is the dedication that the teams have put together. The reason I'm also saying this is that this team has gelled, and we have other infrastructure conferences coming up. This is the first one. Sir, lastly, IMC is 109 years old. And what is our role as a chamber? As a chamber, it is our endeavor in policy participation with government, with policymakers, regulators, but not proactive. We want to be there ahead. And that is something we started with the Reserve Bank of India also, so that our members can have market access, and these are platforms who do that. They can have technology access, and the focus again comes back, reduce cost of money. Thank you, sir. And with this, thank you.
Thank you, sir, for setting the tone of this conference. I time now to felicitate our esteemed guests. I request Mr. Prem Narayan, President IMC, to kindly do the honors. A token of reverence and appreciation for our chief guest, Sri Suresh Prabhuji, Honorable Union Minister for Railways. Sir, kindly accept this. A guest of honor, Mr. Deepak Parekh, Chairman, HDFC Limited. Mr. Lalit Jalan, Chief Executive Officer, Reliance Infrastructure Limited. And Mr. Lalit Jalan, I'm sorry, Mr. Sunil Mathur, Managing Director and Chief Executive Officer, Siemens India. May I now call upon Mr. Harishankaran, Chairman, IMC Infrastructure Committee and Vice Chairman and MD, RNFS, for the introduction of the conference.
Honorable Railway Minister, Mr. Suresh Prabhu, deputies on the dais, friends. This is actually a very, very important day for the IMC and I think for all of us interested in the railway sector. What Mr. Suresh Prabhu and the Railway Ministry has achieved in the last few months is quite remarkable. And I think, therefore, it's apt to paraphrase that effort as a $1 trillion opportunity. It's an opportunity that every member of the IMC, the 2.25 lakh small and medium enterprises, must look at very seriously. International consortium should also look at it very seriously. And to reorient the railways to make these opportunities available for all segments of this economy is what this conference is all about. There's a fundamental shift in orientation, and I must compliment Mr. Suresh Prabhu for this. Sir, you're the first minister that I've actually had the honor of receiving for a conference to come on time, dot on time. And may your trains work in the same fashion, because that will certainly make a big change. We must have role models in order to take something like this forward. And I can think of, we did, as IMC, a very detailed search across many parameters using only published data in order to assess who would be the biggest contributors as a role model to our economy in the railway sector. And I'm very pleased to share with you the results of that. We have Mr. Lalit Jalan, CEO of Rail Infra, Reliance Infra, who run the Metro Rail in Mumbai. And we have Sunil Mathur, CEO of Siemens India, sitting on the dais. Both these organizations have shown why they are considered to be amongst the best in class. And therefore, this morning, IMC is extremely privileged to award both these organizations, Lalit Jalan, for receiving the IMC Best Metro of the Year Award. May I request Deepak, if you can hand it over to him, and Minister, if you can stand in the middle of that. Boss, can I stand behind them? They exchange the trophy. Can the trophy be given, please? Lalit, the idea of giving you this trophy is to improve your service. So Reliance Infra gets it for the best metro based on about 6 or 7 parameters based on published research. And these have been done over the last few months exhaustively. The next trophy is for the most responsible MNC in the sector, Siemens India Limited. And the trophy and the certificate will be received by Sunil Mathur and given to him by Deepak Premnanan in the presence of the Honorable Minister. Awards reflect how we look at currently the best in class. And these two gentlemen certainly in their organizations have shown best in class traits. As I said to Lalit, and I'll say this to Sunil also, we both need you to go up the notch. Mr. Suresh Prabhu and the ministry are opening up the sector for us, and we expect great things going forward. Let me end by thanking all of you for coming to this conference. As I said, it's an important conference. By the end of the day, we'll be publishing a report which will be comprising many of your suggestions and the deliberations of this conference. And that will be submitted to the ministry for further development. I've already found 2 or 3 project proponents in this room, and I think you should use this platform to actually build a case, since all the decision makers are going to be in this panel over the next few hours. Thank you very much, and I hope you have a very productive day.
Thank you, sir. I now request Mr. Lalit Jalan, CEO of Reliance Infrastructure Limited, to address the audience. Mr. Jalan, we are eager to, the minister would like to, we can continue, sir, for a few more minutes, right? Yes. Are you in a hurry, sir? Otherwise, we have Mr. Jalan.
My good friend and the president, Mr. Deepak Premnarayan, my other good friend, chairman of this summit, Mr. Hari Shankaran. I think all are my friends only, so it's like a friends meeting of friends. My other good old friend, Mr. Deepak Parekh, Mr. Lalit Jalan, Sunil Mathur, Mr. Kanodia, Mr. Arvind Pradhan, and I can see so many others who are in the audience, so good morning to all of you. It's pretty embarrassing to speak when so many stalwarts are sitting here as well as there. So I think I would have been better off listening to all of you some pearls of wisdom I would have carried to Delhi, which would help me to do something better. But since I have a positional advantage, let me enjoy it for a while and tell you of something which I would like to share with all of you. Railways is one of the most important infrastructure entity, but it is much more than that, as you all know. And therefore, making it run efficiently is a big necessity. But considering the environment in which we are operating, it is also a big challenge. If you go by certain legacy issues, the railways have always suffered by it, particularly when people expect railways to run very efficiently as a commercial entity. But at the same time, people want it to bear all kinds of burdens, thinking that it also has to carry certain social responsibilities. And this has always created a problem, because when you want to take commercial decisions, the social angle will always be on your mind. If you can't be completely socially oriented organization, then you will not be able to perform your role as a commercial entity. But these are the challenges which are the legacy issues, as I said. And so many other legacy issues, I don't want to dwell on that. But while you do this, no, there cannot be an argument that we should make it run properly, efficiently, and therefore we are trying to work on that in a very significant way. As you know, our Prime Minister, Mr. Narendra Modi, must be probably the first Prime Minister who has been taking so much of interest in the railways, and he has been really pushing railways as one of the prime mover of all the important initiatives of the government, which he keeps talking about it, taking interest about it, and therefore this is a very important priority for him. As I said, there are many issues and many things, so I have been a limited time. I think I also welcome my good colleague and friend Bibek Debroy. So as I can see, my colleague is here, Namita Mehrotra. She will make a presentation after this. So I think you'll go get to know all the issues. So let me not give a speech, but talk about certain points and just speak about a few issues. One is, as I said, many things need to be done in the railways. And many of those things are being done, and I would rather feel most of the things are being done, and in a very comprehensive way. Of course, many people keep now tweeting, saying that the services are improved. And in fact, that is one area which I would start with, because I just mentioned it. It's something which is, and there are a lot of multinational companies sitting here, as well as there, so they can also tell you that is something which is, in a way, unprecedented and probably unparalleled. That while you are traveling, you file your complaint online, and when you do that, you get a response with less than 30 minutes, which is absolutely unprecedented, definitely in India, but probably anywhere in the world. I know many of the non-resident Indians or some foreigners traveling, they said, we cannot even experience something like this in our country. So when they make this complaint, we have a completely integrated system. Any platform from which you make a complaint, it is recorded, the dashboard captures it, the complaint immediately goes to the concerned division, it is monitored there, and probably in many, many cases, we have taken action in less than 30 minutes. That's the target now. And that is something you can imagine. There are 23 million people travel by railways every day. And there are 7 billion people, almost 6 billion plus people travel by it every year. So that's as big as the global population. And despite that, we are attempting to do this. But now we are making it. And therefore, what I was saying about that is that when you make this, so many people say this has improved. Quality of food has improved. Quality of linen has improved. Quality of cleanliness has certainly improved in many places. You know, we are in fact a system now that you can SMS clean my coach, and this is now there in about, I think, 300-400 trains or plus. And then within half an hour, the person goes there and cleans the coach. Now that day something interesting happened. One person congratulated the railways for saying that in half an hour, the person came when I SMS'd and cleaned the coach 4 times. That was it. So but some other person comment on that was very interesting. He said, why we had to clean it in 4 times in half an hour? Who was making it unclean? And that's why now, if we should really take it as an important issue, that is a collective responsibility. But point I'm saying is that while we do this, and there is a marked improvement, and this is social media, so everybody can see it, everybody can read it, this is in public domain. At the same time, some people will always complain, that is not clean. This is not, food is not good. So both are true. But what is important is, first, maybe 2 years ago, people's complaint was about almost 80%, 90% of it, which has now come down dramatically. So still, there would be, it's not universal. So some trains, there could be a problem. There are certain issues related to food could be a problem. But that doesn't mean that what is said by others is not true. While we accept that this is a something which we really need to improve and we want to do that. But we must see the real change that is happening and we want to make it even better. Institutionalize it, that's the most important thing. That's why I was mentioning that now this complaint mechanism itself, we are making it into management information system, MIS. So if you are getting a complaint, particularly from a particular geography, that means there is something wrong with that, or from a particular function, like for example, a food, that means there is something wrong with that particular function, so then we can take corrective action. So in fact, now every day, the complaints which we receive are now first for redressal, that's of immediate priority. But while it is being done, I ask all the members of the railway board to personally monitor it to make sure that in respect to their own function, how that can be improved. And therefore, this is something you can imagine. This is a massive task, but we are still trying to do it. And this is one very good way, is knowing whether a particular activity is good or not, is from the directly from the people themselves. So this is a good feedback system, but also good MIS system. So improving customer experience is something which is one of the top priority. And in that, many, many things. In fact, I don't want to, again, tell you there are maybe what we said in the previous budget as well as in this budget. More or less, last budget, of course, everything we implemented. In this budget, also, whatever we have said, many of these things getting implemented. And they are implemented in public domain by announcing in through media. In fact, every day, I keep telling my friends in Delhi that I feel sorry for you because we keep inviting you every day. Because we are launching something or other every day. And therefore, they also can see it, but this is something. So customer experience, whether it is linen, so we are trying to create more and more mechanized laundries. Wherever it has happened, the complaints have, there are 2 general managers sitting here in front of me. In fact, both are Agarwals. So they can tell you about the improvement that has happened. These 2 areas of linen. Food, we already made it into a choice. If you want to order food of your choice, you can do that by doing e-catering. And this is now more or less in most important trains and most important stations, this is already made available. So whether it is linen, interiors of the coach, again, it is getting a lot of changes. We started one Mahamana train, which was fit. So this is the customer experience. I don't want to dwell more on that. The second part, of course, is infrastructure. How do you actually, what is the problem of railways? One is the punctuality. Now, in fact, this month, it has gone to 82%. This is something which is in the worst of the month because August was a month when there was a lot of disruption, flooding, many other things, but despite that, it has gone up. But still, we are not happy. Our idea is to take it beyond 90% and even above. But that will take some time. But the root cause of that, and that's why I mentioned infrastructure, is that most of the trains get delayed because of lack of infrastructure, because we are running more trains than the infrastructure can handle. And therefore, wherever there are bottlenecks, we are trying to remove them by making doubling or tripling or putting up additional lines. This is a low-hanging fruit because rather than creating new lines, which of course needed to be done, but if you do not actually augment the capacity on the existing infrastructure itself and make it in a manner more efficient, how are you going to work it? So therefore, we are trying to do that. At this infrastructure itself, our target is pretty large. Last year was 1 lakh, this year 1,21,000 crores. And in fact, in addition to that, outside the budget, which my good friend Deepak Premaran mentioned, that one diesel locomotive and electric locomotive, which is going to be manufactured, by GE and Alstom through a very competitive process. In fact, I'm sure my good friend Deepak Parekh and Sunil Mathur, one is the chairman, one is the CEO of the company which lost out, will tell you that how transparent the process was. In fact, some of them told me that they are happy that they lost out. I said, why? Because they said the process was so transparent that we didn't. And they will definitely, I'm sure about it. And we want to. In fact, we want good companies to come, but I'm just talking about a process. So the idea I'm saying is, in addition to the capex that we are incurring through the budget, there is a lot of capex which will happen outside the budget, including the high-speed railways, which is between Mumbai and Ahmedabad, which is almost a lakh 92,000-93,000 crores, which will become 1 lakh crore almost. And that too financed through a very innovative way that we'll get about 50 years tenure loan, which is only 0.1% interest. First 15 years, nothing to be serviced. So all the top finance guys are here. If they can give me a better deal, we'll be more than happy. But this is something, so outside of the budget, also we are trying to resort to financing. So this is going to result into a huge capex, which primarily targeted at improving the present infrastructure as well as augmenting more and also creating more capacity. So this is something which is being done on creating infrastructure. Financing part is very important part because, as you know, the railway's average capex was about 30,000-40,000 crores per year. And most of it was predetermined. For example, the gross budgetary support which Ministry of Finance will give to the railways will be always coming with the tag, where it should be spent, like strategic lines or something like this. So there was hardly any leeway available to the railways to resort to new lines or doubling or tripling or thing like this. So this has been pending for a long time. And obviously, every minister wanted to start new lines into his home state. Consequently, the infrastructure augmentation didn't happen. So financing was always a challenge. Therefore, we resorted to extra budgetary resources. In fact, an institution based here itself, Mumbai Life Insurance Corporation, gave us 1,50,000 crores. That was little above the GSEC. And at 15 years repayment. So this is something which has also resulted into financing in a motorway, but also resorting to financing of different kind. We already, the World Bank is at a very advanced stage of anchoring a fund called Railway Infrastructure Development Fund, which will be co-invested by some of the top pension funds and the sovereign wealth funds. The idea is that we should put the money not only in the railway infrastructure, but not necessarily into government infrastructure. It can be any railway infrastructure, because our idea is to go in for more and more PPPs. So this fund will obviously finance the railway infrastructure, but will also finance the other infrastructure projects related to the railways. For example, and I'll come to it a little later, station redevelopment. This is going to be a major capex. It's going to be a great opportunity. I also requested Mr. Deepak Parekh to guide us on that. He is already going through it. And we want many, many people to actually guide us on that, because this is the massive, the biggest station redevelopment project anywhere in the world. And that too in Indian context, where the station redevelopment presupposes is the present station is going to be developed. And why it is necessary? One is for, the reason is also one more reason, which I'll come to later. But this is also necessary because it's congested. And because it is congested, it's a challenge to redevelop it. If you go to any of the stations in India, the stations are the most sought after destination. People want to board a train, get out of the train. Therefore, a lot of activities have come outside the station, so it has become very difficult now to redevelop it. So this is a very challenging issue. Despite that, we have been able to now start with the first station redevelopment, that is in Habibganj. We just signed about 2 weeks back an agreement, very interesting agreement, between railways, state government of Gujarat, and municipal corporation of Surat. The idea is to develop not just railway station there, integrated transport solution. So this will be the bus station, the railway station, the rickshaws and the taxis, and all of that will be coming there. And this is a very, very interesting concept. And therefore, in fact, 34 companies already expressed interest. So in the next maybe 6 months, actually the idea is to do it even earlier, we'll be able to actually start to work on that. Even for Habibganj, we already started. In 2 more stations, that is in Delhi, in Anand Vihar and Vijwasan. This also will happen in the next few months, as well as other places. But the idea is that this will go into a major important issue. But why are we doing it? Is also to increase the non-fare revenue of the railways. Railways get basically from two sources, freight, two-thirds, and one-third is coming from the passengers. In Japan, it could be even 30%, which will come from non-rail operation. How do you get it? So one of the ways to get it, and that's how Japanese did it, that's how partly UK did it, is by station redevelopment. And therefore, in addition to this, of course, we have created a non-fare revenue directorate, which I had announced in my budget. Again, as is part of implementation, we already created one. One of the dynamic officers, Mr. Thakur, is heading it. And we are already working with one of the top consultants, KPMG, is actually working with us. Idea is to get 10,000 crores from this from the ad revenue part. And many ideas are being rolled out. Of course, as I said, all of this is not going to happen in a hurry. First time we are thinking about ideas like this, for people to accept it, the system must also clear it. It takes time to do all this. But idea is that this is something which is happening. This will also create, in addition to station redevelopment, this also will provide a non-rail revenue. So we are doing not just this, but many other ideas for non-fare revenue. I think this also, you'll have some details on that when Namita will make the presentation on that. Also, as I said, financing station. So I was talking, sorry, I came on the financing, so I just came to the station. So the financing part also, the station redevelopment would need huge resources. Interestingly, the King Cross station, which is one of the most privatized station in UK, in London, sorry. And that station, very interestingly, who owns the station? It is definitely not the railways because it's privatized. But who is owning it? The pension funds own it. The station is owned by the pension funds. But so if you create a railway infrastructure development fund, which is World Bank is anchoring it, then automatically this fund can also invest into something like this. And particularly, the railway is the best destination for any of this pension fund or sovereign wealth fund. Why? Because normally the pension fund would need a long-term investment. Because if I join today as an employee, I'm going to retire for 30 years. So every year I'm going to make a contribution. So I have to be paid only after 30 years. So if I have to be paid after 30 years, the pension fund is not very keen on getting every 5 years new investment. You know, they will of course make new investment from new accruals. But if we get a good long-term investment destination, they will be happy. Also, there must be a permanent revenue. And that's what the pension fund will look at. Thirdly, pension fund will be very keen that a capital should be safeguarded. Because it's all right, good returns, but pension will go, so the pension will go, but tension will remain. So they don't want that to happen. And therefore, capital has to be safeguarded. So even to do that, railway is the ideal entity. It's government, so capital safeguard is not an issue. Permanent revenues, almost $30-35 billion, which will keep increasing. Also, long-term, because railway also need investment for long-term. So station redevelopment and project like this would be an ideal destination. So World Bank, if it is co-anchoring it, will really, rather anchoring it and co-investors will come into it, will be the ideal destination. So World Bank, we already got it. We of course had to, many hurdles had to be cleared, so which we have fortunately been able to do it. So hopefully in the next few will happen. So as I said, many things need to be done. And one of that has to be also speed. Railways in India have to catch up in a big way in that. So we must increase the speed, not only what the others have done, but even better it. So I was talking to my colleagues one day, just 2 months back. This is something which I must compliment my colleagues in the railways. 2 months back, we were talking, and the member rolling stock, now we are actually, that is another part which we have done, is to actually try to restructure the railway board in as many ways as possible. Of course, ideally, people can say this should be done, but we are in a system, as can happen, we are trying to do that. And I was talking to him, and I said, why not we increase the speed beyond what others are thinking? It will not happen in a hurry. The speed should actually happen in a hurry, but maybe not that much of a hurry. But why not we think about it? Yesterday, this was only less than 2 months ago. We talked to about 6-7, we opened the expression of interest. We are top technology players in the world. I said, could we develop a technology within India jointly? So developed in India, make in India, use in India, and then maybe export outside India. Can we do like this? So yesterday, I'm very happy to say, this was only less than 2 months ago, and yesterday we had a major conference in Delhi. All the top companies came, including Hyperloop. And I don't know how many of you are familiar with Hyperloop. This, I don't know, Sunil will be happy with it or not, because it will not need any rolling stock. It will not need any signaling. It will not need any tracks, because this will be going from one place to another. In a way. Of course, this is a technology concept, which technology developed, but we have to use it. So even that company was here, the CEO, we talked to them, and therefore we are trying to do it, trying to do that. So this speed, in the next idea would be, and this not again, some of my friends will ask me, you said that in Mumbai on 3rd of September, but it not happened. This is today, 30th September 2016, that not happened. You talked about speed, what happened about it? So it's not going to happen in that fast, but if you don't think about it today, it will not happen, forget 2016, it will not happen till 2050 or 2060 also. So we have started planning about it. The idea is that not more than 12 hours from one destination to another in India. And that will take some time, obviously, because it's only a rolling stock we are talking about today. It needs other things to fall in place. But point I'm saying is, this is something which, again, is a speed, is one of the important issues. Technology is something which are using, in addition to speed, in almost all areas. Whether it is using drones, whether it is using automatic tracking machine, or whether trying to do all kinds of things. So we are trying to do that. To bring structural changes, we are trying to create a regulator, which, as again, there are so many things, as I said, the system has to, but we have done it. Delegation, which has happened in the railways, which I think, and my good friend Sanjeev Aliwale is here, he would tell you, because he also worked in the government for a long time. Now he writes, so it's, I don't know which is more difficult. But, you know, in delegation, it is unprecedented. Again, railways was the most centralized organization. We are delegated, at least my own powers, to every general manager. And two general managers here can ask them. They worked in the railways for 25, 30 years. Did he have experienced any kind of power like this any time in the past? No tender comes to the minister. It all goes to them, including the more or less the powers related to posting, promotion, transfers is not. So many people come to me, I have to disappoint them because they think minister can immediately order and then he'll transfer from Mr. Agarwal, he'll go from here to Chennai tomorrow. It doesn't happen like that. We have actually made a proper structure. So the idea is that also changing structure. There are many things in structure, I don't want to dwell upon that. Safety is an important issue. And again, we want to work on that. A lot of things needs to be done in that. In fact, I have already written to my good friend and colleague, the finance minister, if they can give us 1 lakh crore over the next 5 years' time, we can actually change the safety in a big way. But this has many other advantages. So safety is also would mean that we can create more and more, avoid the level crossing, which is a major cause of accident, which will mean also the speed can increase. So there are a lot of spin-off benefits which will come out of just safety when we address it as a standalone issue, but we can actually get many benefits out of it. In HR, of course, we have done many things. We have started working on audit. Then also the selection process itself. Even in DRM and GM, a lot of things we are trying to change. So the HR is one of the most principal ideas for it. We are trying to work on state joint ventures. In fact, this will be a complete game changer. Every budget, the chief minister will come to Rail Bhavan, make a wish list, and then he'll go back to his own state capital and say, I made the demand, but central government is not sensitive. They don't do it. So this is good for the chief minister because he's addressing an audience back home. Good for the railway minister, said, I heard you, but what can I do? Nothing can happen because I have my limitation. So it was a good dialogue. So I think many chief ministers were saved of a trouble of creating a fresh memorandum every year. They could carry the previous year memorandum because same thing was had to be said again. So we changed it, and now we are trying to make it into a joint venture with the states. 16 states had agreed in principle. At least 10 more states have joined. And in fact, I'll tell you which are the states. You'll be surprised. Kerala, which agreed to join, has a chief minister, Mr. Vijayan, now. When they agreed in principle yesterday, now they've created a cabinet, everything has gone, so they again came to sign. But when they agreed in principle, the chief minister was Mr. Oman Chandy. When he came to me, I proposed to him, he came with the leader of opposition then, Mr. Achyutanand, who is also from CPM, but former chief minister, that time leader of opposition. Both of them agreed. Now Mr. Vijayan, as a chief minister who was not neither of that, neither a chief minister nor leader of opposition, has also agreed. So that shows that a state like Kerala, which otherwise is supposed to be now the communist or, you know, different type of, but they are also working with us. So they are Andhra Pradesh, Karnataka, Telangana, Maharashtra, Gujarat, Haryana, many, many states. So what is the idea? The idea would be that when we implement, you normally, central government, that this is one only ministry where everything is done by the central government. Education, healthcare, even transportation, other ministries, we have to work with the state. But railways is one thing. So it's advantages as well as one of the disadvantages was that we can implement a project anywhere if we can do it in air somewhere. We need land. For any project, any kind of thing has to have land. We need local permission. We need local support. And many of the areas where we are actually doing it, the law and order is also an issue which needs to be tackled. If the state government joins as partner, it's a complete game changer. In fact, I'll tell you how it is going to change. We now in Maharashtra, and in fact, day after, on Thursday, we are going to have a review meeting of all this. The chief minister of Maharashtra has said number of times publicly, openly, including on assembly, that the state government will give 10,000 crores for the railways. Can you imagine? A state government saying that they want to give 10,000 crores for the railways, which otherwise would be a demand from the railway ministry. Now, what can we do with this? We can have a joint venture in which they will take, of course, the equity pattern is 50-50, 51-49. They will take equity more or less equally. And we did not put 100% as equity. And there are some stalwarts sitting here, so I should not tell you what should be the financing pattern, what should be debt equity ratio and stuff like this. But with that, earlier, this was something which was happening. But how was it happening? The Kerala will deposit 50, not Kerala, but Karnataka was first state, deposit 50% of the cost of project with the central government. And many cases has happened when they agreed, the cost of project was 1,000 crores. So they deposited 500 crores. After 10 years, project is still not taken off for many reasons, land, these, other. So they will come and tell you what happened. They said, you have to pay 50%. You have not given 50%, you have given only 10%. He said, how? I give 500 crores when you ask, but cost of project is now 5,000 crores. So now it is never going to happen. So this was one way. But more importantly, giving 50% from your side and 50% from our side is a presumption that states and central government has got plenty of money. They don't know how to spend. That's why 50-50 sharing is going to work. Both are having same problem. And particularly after pay commission, I'll come to it as a challenge for the railway. I'm telling you all these things. Also, there are challenges, which I'll come last and finish my speech. So state government can now put some equity. We put equity. It can be leveraged 3 times, 4 times. And we talk to multilateral agencies, ADB, World Bank, JICA, as well as even financing agencies like us. I'm sure ILFS will be more than happy. But State Bank of India, Mr. Arundhati Bhattacharya, is more than keen to finance it. Mr. Rajiv Lal from IDFC office, Deepak Parekh was chairman till recently. Many others, so are willing to find. So what will happen? We'll actually get a project with more same capital, with leverage, because leverage more, we can undertake many more projects. Also, because the banks are now going to verify it, it also means that their project cannot be taken the type of project that you wanted. Earlier, I don't want to name a state, a chief minister came, and they are now our partners. This is not Kerala, of course, I don't want to, but some other state. The chief minister came, and we decided which projects to take. He said, we must take those projects which are commercially viable. Now, just see the change. A chief minister telling me, don't take a project which is not commercially viable. Now, because he realizes that it has to be serviced, so project must pay for itself. And luckily, when we do this, it doesn't come into the Fiscal Responsibility and Budget Management Act. So the states also are not burdened with any debt, additional debt. But the advantage of this is that states which otherwise were demanding from railways that take this project because it is your problem. So I can always make a statement back home that minister is not sensitive. Now the same change, because we have become partners, We are taking project which will be commercially viable. And as I'm saying, not necessarily 100% should be commercially viable. 70-80% can be commercially viable. 20-30% can be socially desirable. So a blending can be made. But this is again something state partnership is going to result into. Just imagine, now the state will have a completely new management structure. It increases the management bandwidth because only railways were going to implement a project. How can they implement? Because the same people will have to implement, the same CEO in general manager's office will have to implement. But now if you get another entity, maybe some people will be, of course, deputed from railways, but it's a completely different entity, different management structure, different board of directors with completely different financing pattern. The management bandwidth increases, which should result into more projects getting implemented at a faster pace. And because the state governments are partners, so many of these hurdles which normally have to be encountered while implementation, like clearances, land, everything will be properly tackled. So the speed of implementation can go up considerably. How much? We are already trying to increase the speed of railway projects to about 8 to 11 kilometers a day in the next few years' time. Just imagine, even then, this is a great because it used to be only less than 4 kilometers a day. So what we have improved is something we can feel very proud, but I'm not very happy because this is not going to result into what we desire to do it. So what is the challenge? We must increase the speed. How do you increase it? Because the railway, same machinery, same thing, we can always put additional ideas, etc. But the state government doing it now with a completely different management team, different structure, different financing streams, even if they do 10 kilometers a day each state, which is definitely doable, just imagine 10 states doing it, how much per day we can add? So you just imagine. So this is a change which is going to take place. So, and this is another thing, as I said, what our Prime Minister always says, cooperative federalism. This is the true cooperative federalism in works, which is going to happen, and all the states. So I want to, that's why I was telling you, that's why I took example of Kerala, the communist state, which is our partner. We, of course, are not including northeastern state for the same reason, for the reason that they don't have their own resources. But the states which are resources will be the ideal partners, and also the largest state. So this is what we are trying to do. We are also trying to work on many of these things. And there are, of course, a lot of challenges for the railways. One is this year, a burden of pay commission itself will be about 35,000 crores. Additionally, the railways, which even Mr. Bibek Debroy has pointed out, at least 30,000-40,000 crores of additional public service obligations. We also have the dividend payment liabilities, which is about 10,000-15,000 crores. We also have the bonus, which the our government as a welfare measure had done, and it's a very right measure to increase the minimum, the ceiling on bonus payment. So that resulted into railway being the largest employer has to pay the highest. So therefore, despite all this, one challenge. Secondly, the freight, which is the 2/3 of the income of the railways, we have created a capacity of 1.2 billion tons, 1,200 million tons of capacity, which is available to the railways to carry the freight. Now, we are a transporter. So transporter has to, what is the transport obligation as of to freight? We can keep everything ready. But if there is no cargo coming in, what can transport do about it? But that's why we are also trying to do this. We are diversifying the entire basket, going beyond coal. Coal is a 50% of the total freight that we handle. So going beyond coal, we are doing all that, all structural changes we are doing. In fact, in the freight, first time we have reduced the freight fare. We have also reduced so many hurdles, we have removed them. We have made it completely friendly. We are talking to all the players, including our general managers, our DRMs, keep meeting them, the players who are going to give it. But this still is a challenge. In China, the freight volume went down last year by almost 13%. 13% went down by 30, volumes, freight volumes. This year, China is happy because it's gone down by only 8%. But still gone down by 8%. In India, luckily, with all this adverse, because China is facing 13% down. What are we down? Zero. We, in fact, are still positive. We are increasing volume, but still not as much as we want. But we are ready to handle 1.2 billion tons of cargo. Earlier, the member traffic was the most sought-after person, and he was the most unavailable person, because everybody was go to him and tell him, I want wagon. He didn't have wagon to give, so everybody is going to blame him. Wagon is not. So he used to move around everywhere, so because people will not come and harass him. Now, our member traffic is chasing the customer. He is going there, talking to them, finding out, how can I give you wagon? Wagon's available. Tell me, what can I do for you? But this is one challenge of freight. As I said, the cost is the other challenge. And changing an organization, but you know, this is something, again, changing a culture of the organization is not something which can happen overnight. And you are running such large entities like, you know, all of you know. So therefore, despite this, I must say that the organization is gearing up. We are trying to do it. And the result of this will be felt more as we go along. Like, for example, delegation. You know, any private sector company, and there are many CEOs here, will tell you, the CEO calls his executives and tell them, you have all the powers, do whatever you want. For 6 months, they will feel really has said it, or that they probably, I don't know what hour of the day it was, what was he doing with his friends before he said this. And I don't know whether he's serious or not. Next day, he's going to come and ask me, when I told you this. So getting power, people must feel that it is real. And that's why, like I gave an example, that if you're blindfolded for 6 months, and you come into bright sunshine, you cannot say anything. So if everything was done in the central level, and now you are given the powers, it takes time for people to sink in, to understand the systems, to develop, to make that happen, though we have developed the system, all of this happening. But this is going to be a game changer as you go along, because people are now realizing, and I can see that. Some of the general managers tell me that we used to take 2 years, 3 years, 2.5 years for sanction. Now it happens in less than 6 months. This is already happening. Does it mean that it's happening in 100% cases? It depends on the type of person, type of situation. But change is completely visible, but that needs to be institutionalized, as I said, and that's why we are doing it. To make sure now taking the next step, and I don't know whether my colleagues here, two general managers, will be happy with this, is that we have come out with a new system called key result areas. Now we are telling them, already we have signed with them, that on 9 or 10 parameters, your performance will be judged. So key result areas are the areas in which many of the parameters will be judged. So this one is the power, we'll be very happy, but now comes with the responsibility. So this again is a KRA, is something in the government system you would feel is a remarkable thing, but probably anywhere in the corporate culture also to have something very as specific as this, we are trying to do that. And therefore, we are also changing the accounting system, which is completely different than what we would have would imagine. I'll tell you what we are trying to do. First, there has been, rightly so, people saying they should change from single into double entry, and also from cash to accrual. But in my opinion, that is something necessary, absolutely has to be done, but we should go beyond it. So what we are doing is, we are now trying to take right from budgeting, expenditure, output, and outcome. The whole chain of event need to be captured, integrating. Now he's a chartered accountant, Shailesh Haribhakti, so I should not be speaking too much. And also Bhavana sitting behind him. Both are our former Central Council members and senior leaders. Deepak Bhai also has forgotten, but he's also a chartered accountant. And this, if you do, and integrate costing, management accounting system, MIS, all of that into one, it would be a complete change of bringing in even these key result areas into a completely different level. We're also working on ERP. TCS, Mr. Chandrasekhar, I don't know whether he's here or not, he told me this is probably the biggest ERP anywhere in the world, and he's a CEO of TCS with and $75-80 billion of market cap, so he knows what he's speaking. And he has tried to, so we are working on the ERP. So these both the things happening, I can see in the, and that will take about 2-3 years to actually get it implemented. When that happens, you can see a completely different operation. The railway, not only technologically, management-wise, administratively, financially, will be operated on a completely different level. And that is what is already happening. We are already working at all these issues in an integrated manner. The idea is that we must work on all the issues at the same time to make sure that whole thing happens. I'll give an example. It is a real story. When Christian Bernard, I think, I don't know whether I'm calling his name, Deepak is from, he's on the board of directors of a South African bank, he will know it better. The first heart transplant operation took place in Cape Town, in South Africa. Christian Bernard was a doctor, probably. After the operation was successful, everybody was monitoring, heart, because heart was transplanted first time. Everybody was monitoring. Like Neeraj will monitor badminton, table tennis. He was a table tennis champ. So everybody was monitoring. What is happening? After a few days, the patient died. So the doctors, particularly the doctor went to the widow, said, I want to do an autopsy to find out what is the cause of the death. He said, well, you accidented enough while he was alive. Now leave his body, to let it go. But he said, no, please, this is important. So they investigated, and they found out